boys of the Fatstock Marketing Corporation has taught me that what the customer wants is not always quite the same as what a judge of livestock's looking for.
Now, look here, John. Let me tell you something. If I can't produce a better beef animal than you, I'll eat my hat.
You'd better get your pepper and salt out.
I shan't need no pepper and salt. You come out.
So there we were, once again at it, hammer and tongs. And the upshot of it all was that a bit later on, as we were looking at my cattle, he couldn't resist bringing it up again.
I'd like to take you up on this judgment business, Albert, but first of all, what do you mean by a better beast? I reckon to give me the best return, I must aim to please the butcher. That is the consumer.
Agreed. I'm not just talking about a show beast either. Come over here. I'll show you a steer that'll beat anything you've got.
That Hereford cross there, see?
Mm-hmm.
He's a real beauty, isn't he?
Uh-huh. Right. Well, I've got a pole steer in that bunch over there to beat him. That belted one nearest to us. Mind you, by your standards, he perhaps doesn't look all that much. But as you've agreed, it's the meat under the hide that matters. Now, are you prepared to put him up against that one?
Anytime you like. But to satisfy me, they'll have to be judged alive as well as dead. How are you going to manage that?
That's easy. If you don't mind, we'll enter them for the FMC Fatstock competition, a fortnight on Friday in Stockworthy. There, they'll be judged alive by one panel of judges, and again as carcasses by another.
Right. I'll give it a go.
Right.
And if it's all the same to you, we'll have a fiver on the live judging and another on the carcasses.
Done. I'll see you at the show.
Good morning, Albert.
Hello, John.
I'm Jim Wood, the county representative of FMC. Jim, this is my neighbor.
Albert Simmons.
How do you do, Mr. Simmons?
Pleased to meet you.
I've heard a bit about the little bet that you and John have on. As a matter of fact, I think they're just starting to judge your class now. We'd better find ourselves
a seat. Yes, come on.
Yes, we'd better get a move on if we want to get a good position.
He's picked out, I see, two Angus and some shorthorns. The numbers on the rumps of these cattle correspond with the numbers in your catalogue. Well, ladies and gentlemen, entering the ring are the first selection. The judge has already been into the lairage and picked out from class two. This comprises steers. Number four has been picked out as among the better half of these cattle. This is a white shorthorn steer entered by Mr. P.
That's your steer, isn't it, Mr. Simmons? The judge certainly seems to have taken a fancy to it. But you know, I don't agree with his placing. In my view, John's beast will be more readily saleable as a carcass.
Look here, doesn't the judge know his own job, then?
Well, with live judging, it's still largely a matter of tradition, you know.
I don't say that this judge is not being a bit more practical than his counterparts in the show ring, but the same tendencies are there. He's inclined to choose cattle which show character, stand well, and have good carriage. Judges of live cattle prefer animals showing very little daylight underneath them, which necessitates a deep chest and a well-let-down flank. But what real commercial value has a straight top line, or for that matter, a straight underline? Live judging is not realistic enough, and too often it's not done with the end product in mind. Now you see, in spite of what I said about John's bullock, it hasn't been placed. But I still say it's a good one.
It'll be most interesting to see what these animals look like on the hoof.
Never mind about that now. John's bullock's just lost him a fiver, and at this rate, it's as likely as not to lose him another before the day's out.
We shall see about that.
Well, I was wrong in the end. When you see the carcasses hanging up, you can well appreciate the importance of the proportion of more expensive cuts to the less expensive from the butcher's point of view. As far as I know, the butchers want an animal with some length from pins to shoulder, and the short-backed, deep-chested type is not their ideal. On the other hand, they don't mind a bullock being a bit high off the ground, as long as it shows a full butt. I came to the general conclusion that what they want are young, well-grown cattle, almost of a bacon pig type. The carcass judges were much more pleased with John's steer than mine. It showed signs of youth, had less flank, brisket, and neck, and in proportion, more buttock, loin, and rib roast. Another thing the butcher is very keen about is a good eye of lean meat. But the interesting thing is that what really let me down was the heavy suet fat on my beast. But how can you spot things like that in the live animal? After the competition, I got talking to Mr. Woods about FMC and its methods.
The great thing about dead weight and grade is that it gives the producer a fair return in terms of pence per pound for what he produces. It also gives him the full benefit of better breeding, feeding, and management methods that are designed to yield a high killing out percentage. This leaflet will show what I'm getting at.
Suppose FMC is paying 30 pence per pound for grade A beef. That price is based on the current average market price converted from shillings per hundredweight live weight to pence per pound dead weight. To make this conversion, you can use a killing out percentage of 54, the figure that the ministry guarantees are based on. On this basis, FMC would be paying 30 pence per pound when the average market price is around 151 shillings a hundredweight, including the guarantee. The average return from a 10 hundredweight animal would be £75.10 on live weight, and it would be the same from FMC on dead weight if it killed out at 54%. But look what happens if it kills out at 55%. Just 1% better, and there's an extra 30 shillings from FMC on the total return.
And for every 1% beyond that, there's an extra 30 bob to come. And that makes a big difference in your net profit. On dead weight and grade, you get the benefit if your beast kills out well.
How about lambs, then? There's no question of a conversion there, because the price is usually in pence a pound, no matter how you market them.
Agreed, but on live weight, it is on estimated dead weight, and not as with FMC, the actual weight of carcass produced. FMC puts the carcasses on a scale, and you know you've been paid for what you've produced. With FMC, you cut out all this estimating of weights, and stock at the right point of maturity will often kill out well, and yield that additional pound or two of meat that you didn't expect.
Well, the reason I asked particularly about lambs is because I've got some that are just about ready now. And I've a mind to send a batch along to you and see how I get on with them. Perhaps you'd tell me how I go about that. Oh.
I wasn't very sure of what type of lambs FMC wanted, so Mr. Woods came to see me the next day. He'd asked me to have the lambs penned, and they were ready when he arrived. There were about 40 of them, and I told him I wanted to send roughly half to FMC. As he drew the lambs, Mr. Wood ear-tagged them. This, he told me, was the foolproof method of identification used by FMC, every animal having its own tag number. He drew 20 in all, and I noted that he seemed to favor those that were fairly light but adequately finished. Afterwards, he told me that a lot of farmers were tending to keep their lambs on until they were rather too heavy for the general demand. He agreed with me that there were good prices to be had for the heavier lambs, sometimes, and in some localities, but he pointed out that the market for heavy lambs could soon get oversupplied. It took only a minute or so to fill up the entry form. I was told the haulier would call for them. Something I quickly learned was there's not much bother for the farmer in dealing with FMC. Before he left, Mr. Wood suggested that I might be interested in going to the abattoir to see my first consignment go through. I told him that I'd be glad to. The haulier turned up at the appointed time, and as mine were being loaded, I noticed that the float had a good many lambs on board already. I realized that, being a big organization, FMC is able to do a lot to keep transport costs and the like down to the minimum. Mr. Woods arrived as the float was leaving, and he remarked that in the normal way, this was the point at which I could forget all about my lambs, and all I would need to do was to bank the check when it arrived. As we had a few minutes to spare, I showed him round, and I let him have a look at some of my cattle. I wouldn't be surprised if he's back to see them again shortly. Then we followed the float down to the abattoir in his car, and he reminded me that producers were always welcome to visit the FMC slaughter points whenever their stock was being killed. I'd been favorably impressed during my visit to the abattoir to the Fatstock competition,
And this time I was able to see clearly that it was unlike any abattoir I had ever imagined. Pleasantly situated on the outskirts of the town, clean, hygienic, and full of orderly activity. I was particularly interested in this visit because both Mr. Woods and John Anderson had made a great point of the fact that the farmer's interest does not finish when he sends his stock from his farm. This point of view was also maintained by Mr. Cummings, the FMC stockworthy manager, who said,
"Well, it's up to the producer to see that his stock is what is required by the trade. In other words, that he must produce to meet consumer demands. Now, this is the slaughter hall. We finished the cattle hill for the day, and we are now putting through the remainder of the lambs. I don't think yours will be along yet. Meanwhile, let's have a look round, shall we?"
"Yes, I'd like that very much, thank you."
"This happens to be one of the more modern slaughterhouses in the country, and here we operate on the line system. This simply means that there is a continuous process from the animal entering the slaughterhouse to the time it enters the selling bay. At the moment, you are looking at a stage in that process where the lambs, and I don't know whose they are being weighed and graded by the ministry grader. The whole secret of identification rests in the ear tag. The clerk on your right records the weight and grade for the ministry purposes, and the other clerk facing the scale is our own check weighman, who, as each carcass goes over the scale, checks and records the weight and grade of each carcass, and at the end of the day, the two sets of records are checked against each other."
"Now, that's all very interesting, but how does the grader differentiate between the various grades?"
"Well, I'm pleased you asked me that question, Mr. Simmons. Ah, the very man. Mr. Bush! Mr. Bush! Could I introduce Mr. Simmons to you?"
"How do you do?"
"His first entry of lambs just arrived, and he's come to see them through. Would you be good enough to give him a short explanation, do you think?"
"I'd be glad to. There's a batch around here will just suit the purpose admirably."
"Mr. Bush is a ministry grading supervisor."
"The grading standards were laid down by the ministry in consultation with the livestock industry, both the meat trade and your own National Farmers Union."
"Yes."
"Now, to estimate the grade of a carcass, we apply three measures, and how each carcass meets those measures actually determines its grade. Now, I should like to show you how those three measures apply to these carcasses here."
"Uh-huh."
"Take this carcass as an example. Judging that from the conformation measure, it has a well-developed loin and broad. It has full and plump legs. It has a thick shoulder and a comparatively short neck. One can really judge that straight away as an A carcass from the conformation angle. For quality, it has a streakiness of fat inside the flank muscles, also between the ribs. The ribs are narrow and slightly red in color. The knuckle joints are red in color and moist. Finish, smooth, even fats. And that is perfect in this respect. And that is a grade A carcass. Now next, we have a carcass from a conformation point of view, which absolutely fails. It has a narrow loin. It is not fully developed. Its legs are very mean in meat value, a bigger proportion of bone. The shoulders are not big enough, and it has an elongated neck. So there's no need to talk about that any longer. It's a B carcass on conformation alone. Now when we come to this third carcass, it's even worse than the one we have just been talking of. It is weaker in the loins. The legs are even more shanky, as we call it. That is, lacking in meat content. The shoulder is very, very thin, and it has a very elongated neck. So any other qualifications of that carcass do not matter."
"Well, I feel much more confident now that I've seen and heard all about this grading business. Thank you very much indeed."
"Not at all, Mr. Simmons. It's been a pleasure explaining it to you. I only wish that more farmers would show as much interest in the grading of their stock as you have today."
"Thank you. Goodbye."
"Goodbye."
"Thank you very much, Mr. Bush."
"Right.
Well, come along, Mr. Simmons. Let's go and have a look at the children now, shall we?" "Well, Mr. Simmons, as you can see, there's a considerable amount of meat here. In fact, everything the butcher wants, eh? There's a good line of lambs, Mr. Simmons."
"Yes, they look very nice indeed. Well, that was very interesting. Thank you."
"Oh, good. Well, here at the end of the line, we have the selling bay. And over there, as you can see, is my sales manager talking to one of the local butchers, with a view to making a sale.
Oh, yes. As we came into the car park, I noticed some FMC vans loading up. Now, how do they fit into the picture?
Well, we have two types of trade here. Over there, behind the scale, we have a local butcher. He's not quite certain of us yet and prefers to come to the selling bay and choose for himself. The other one is one we've built up on reputation and goodwill as an order trade, where our customers merely ring us up for the supply of sides of beef, lamb, or pork carcasses. And they depend upon us to supply them with the type of meat they require for their particular class of trade. And to keep this going, Jim Woods and I have to work pretty closely together.
Oh, yes, I can well believe that. Now then, what about delivery services?
They extend at the moment to about 40 miles from the slaughterhouse. But I can assure you, we would deliver even further if the business was sufficiently attractive.
40 miles, eh? But surely, above a certain distance, delivery direct from the slaughterhouse to the butcher's shop would be uneconomical, wouldn't it?
Oh, not if we went about it in the right way. Oh, yes, come into the office for a moment, will you?
Oh, thank you.
You see, the future aim of the Fatstock Marketing Corporation as a national body is to develop a pattern of slaughtering and processing facilities related to the pattern of fatstock production.
Oh, yes.
Well, it really isn't as complicated as it sounds. Take any big stock-producing area. As you can see, to serve this area, FMC would aim to provide a large, centrally located factory abattoir. Pre-war, the tendency was to build abattoirs in the centers of population. But the new FMC factory abattoir may be relatively remote from the big towns served by the production area. And its raw material, livestock, will need to travel only relatively short distances before slaughter. In the towns, FMC will provide meat sales depots radiating from the factory abattoir, and the abattoir will supply each of these depots with meat selected according to its individual requirements. Any meat surplus to the needs of the surrounding centres of consumption will be moved out of the area from the abattoir by road, rail, and even by air. You can see, of course, that one of the ultimate aims of this system is that it will be carcass meat and not livestock that is moved over long distances. From the FMC depots in the towns, there will be a delivery service to the individual butcher shops, already well developed in many parts of the country. The aim will be to build up an order trade on description wherever our customers find it convenient. Or they can still come to the depot to choose for themselves if they want to. This system is already being referred to as the new look for meat marketing. We think this will result in big economies, which will mean better returns for the producer and must mean better service for both farmers and butchers. Oh, I beg your pardon, Mr. Simmons. Would you like to sit down?
Oh, thank you very much. Well, that all sounds very good, but a bit ambitious.
Yes, it's long-term planning, of course, and it needs money. We've already had to acquire more and better facilities for dealing with the byproducts. We've built new depots, improved existing ones, extended our transport fleet, and so on.
One thing that intrigues me is how all this money is being raised.
The most interesting way we've raised cash for capital development is through the issue of loan notes to members of the corporation. You see, the board of FMC believes that all this development is being undertaken for the farmer and that he should be given a really worthwhile opportunity to invest in it himself. They've been proved, right, by the success of the loan notes. FMC Stockworthy Depot? Yes? Who? Oh. Jim! Jim!
Yeah?
It's for you. Hold on a moment, will you? It's the area office. They want some cattle in a hurry. Excuse me, will you, Mr. Simmons?
Of course.
Hello, Wood speaking. Yes. 20. 9 to 10 hundredweight. Yes, I know the sort they want. I'll be able to find them. I'll ring you in the morning and let you know how I get on. Right. Goodbye. Those cattle are wanted 100 miles away from here in another of our areas by Friday. That means I've got to get cracking. Can I drop you off at home on the way, Mr. Simmons?
Well, thank you very much. I think I've seen about everything. But tell me, does that sort of thing happen often?
Oh, it's happening all the time. The marketing division at head office know where there is surplus stock to fill deficiencies in other areas. And they ask one area to fulfill the needs of the other. Then it's up to the field staff like myself to find the stock. And not only that, it has to be the right type of stock, of course. Oh, Joe, we must be on our way, I'm afraid. I've got to find those cattle, and Mr. Simmons is being dropped off on the way.
Oh, just before you go, would you like to see your lambs hung up? They've just come through, and a very good lot they are, too. You've got 18 A's and 2 B's. And on your own estimate of the live weight, they've averaged about 2 pound over halves.
Well, that's good to hear, but I won't stop now because Mr. Woods is in rather a hurry to get away, and I've seen quite enough to satisfy me. Goodbye for now.
Goodbye, sir.
There'll be another lot, you can be sure of that, and maybe I'll come along and see them on the hook. Tell me, Mr. Woods, supposing I were to send more stock to you, could I stipulate that they should always be killed at this abattoir?
Well, most of the time that would be possible. But you must remember that this area produces more than its own requirements, and that it had to supply other parts of the country with stock at times. FMC, being a national organization, has to cope with the problems of supply and demand on a national scale. And that means keeping up a continuous, changing flow of supplies, sometimes involving long distances. Take the month of May as an example. At that time, cattle are still being moved from arable farms in the eastern counties to all the main consuming areas. And at the same time, early spring lambs are being moved from the southwest. No one month is like another, and all the time, FMC is planning its operations to find the best markets for stock as the production pattern changes. Over the whole year, the pattern becomes extremely complex. Let's just take a look at the lamb production picture. The seasonal movement of lambs starts in April, when the first spring lambs are coming out of Cornwall and Devon. By May, more lambs are coming from other western districts. And in June, the Welsh lambs are coming forward in big numbers, while the southwestern traffic is now in full spate. In July, the export of lambs from the southwest peters out, but a start is made from the later districts, such as northwest and south Scotland. In July and August, we have a considerable movement of Welsh hill lambs, and Scotland is sending increasing numbers southwards by the end of August. In September, the flow of lambs is at its peak, and many thousands are moved from the higher districts. Of course, FMC takes its full part in these major movements, and in a good many of the smaller and more localized ones too. Cattle have, of course, to be moved too, and FMC staff in the cattle exporting areas must have a thorough knowledge of what is wanted in the various consuming areas. This means that when they are asked to supply stock for movement out of an area, they can make an accurate selection. In some districts, such as the remote parts of North Wales, collecting centres have been found to provide a suitable method of stock procurement. Here again, it is possible for stock to be selected carefully and economically loaded for ultimate destinations, ensuring that the best possible returns can be obtained for the producer. As I've already said, it is not just livestock that takes part in these movements. FMC has developed long-distance transport of meat for large markets in its own big modern road vehicles, in addition to the traditional rail transport of carcasses. It is our constant endeavor to develop new outlets, new markets, on behalf of the producer who sends stock to FMC. The air freight of lamb carcasses to the continent, for the quality trade in Paris, for example, is now well established. Also a flourishing rail and sea trade with the continent in carcass meat. This includes a good deal of beef of manufacturing quality, which, as you know, isn't readily saleable in this country. You'll realize, of course, that I've been dealing mainly with the cattle and sheep side of our business, but we offer other services to producers, pigs and poultry, for example. FMC handles the great majority of the national production of bacon pigs. We have contracts with a large number of bacon curers for the supply of pigs. This means an all-year-round jigsaw puzzle for FMC and its pig supply officers to ensure the satisfactory distribution of supplies from all over the country to the factories. FMC's arrangements with the curing industry really means a reliable, trouble-free service for the producer.
Well, I don't need to be told any more about FMC being a go-ahead concern. There's a very great deal more to it than meets the eye. Well, Mr. Woods, I know you're in a bit of a hurry, so I won't take up any more of your time. I'm very much obliged to you for all your help, and you'll certainly be hearing from me again.
Goodbye, Mr. Simmons. Give my regards to John Anderson, and don't forget to tell him your grading results.
Ah.
Evening, George. Evening,
find you here. I've just got back from the FMC abattoir, and I reckon I owe you a drink.
Well, thank you, Albert. And have a mild and bitter.
Two mild and bitters, George, please.
How did those lambs go?
They were just right for killing. All A's except two, and I'll bet that's as good as anything you've ever done.
Don't you believe it? Ah. Yeah.
Cheers. Oh, that's better.
The last lot I sit in were all A's.
You've got a lot to learn, Albert.
How do you mean? A lot to learn.
It's the feeding that counts.
Well, that was the way of it. And I don't mind admitting now that I hadn't gone into this marketing business carefully enough. I've got to agree, we've all got to agree, that what John Anderson said is right. The true value of an animal is the price the consumer is prepared to pay. On dead weight and grade, then, you're on a sure thing, because you're paid for what is actually there when the skin comes off. And that's halfway to the dinner plate, so to speak. Not only that, you're being paid for every last pound of meat that your beast yields. John Anderson has often told us that trading with FMC has given him a clear idea of what the consumer wants. I can see now what he means. Prices? Well, FMC try to maintain an overall level of prices which are competitive, avoiding sharp ups and downs, and ensuring a fair and reasonable return to the producer throughout the year. So there does seem to be everything to gain and nothing to lose by sending stock to FMC, providing you don't do too much messing about in trying to get the best of two worlds. If I sent a good proportion of my stock to FMC this next year, I reckon I'll learn quite a lot about the job from the production point of view. After all, it's a bit different now from what it was during control, and even pre-war come to that. We need something like FMC to show us the way to better meat marketing. I say, good luck to FMC.